Hello, I'm Renata.
And I'm Sindre.
And this is Gitarre Humanum.
I released a YouTube video this week.
Yes, you did.
Thank you for the confirmation.
You gained quite a few new followers.
No, not really. But I did get covered by a big news aggregator website. I got quite a few views on it. It was from Boing Boing, the net site.
I've never heard of them.
No, but I got a lot of traction from it. So, and it's the first video essay that I have ever made.
Yeah, because you're planning to make several. But maybe you would like to talk about this particular video?
Yeah, because this is based on an article I wrote on my website, sindralf.com, a few years ago. And I've written a lot of articles about pop culture and stuff like that.
Mm.
Some about my personal life too, but the most popular ones are always about different types of pop culture.
Mm-hmm.
And yeah, I got some readers, but most people, including myself, don't spend a lot of their free time on the internet reading. It's more podcasts and YouTube videos. So I decided that I was going to make video adaptations of a lot of my articles.
And this is like your first serious video, if I may say that?
Yeah, I've been making some videos before. Like, even when I was a teen, I started making videos when I was a teen. And some of it was I was filming me and friends in, like, running around in the forest, making a Pokemon parody in Norwegian and stuff like that. And editing it together and using copyrighted music.
Oh.
And I put it on YouTube. But I also made some, I think they're called AMVs.
What's that?
Maybe that's only for animation. I think that the A in that is animation, but there's a lot of people on the internet that use different television shows or movies and then splice them together with music.
Oh, yeah, those.
Yeah, and I made some of those based on the villains in Doctor Who, the British science fiction show.
Mm.
And the villains are the Daleks. And I took a lot of clips from them and spliced them together with music and made it look really cool. I think they still hold up. But I used copyrighted music, like popular music. And if you want to have a career on YouTube, you try not to use copyrighted stuff, especially music. They are very strict on that.
Yeah, as they probably should be.
Yeah. In recent years, I have really enjoyed watching video essays on YouTube. That's, I think, my favorite video genre on YouTube. So naturally, I wanted to make some of my own.
Yes. And this first one was about a Norwegian painter.
Yeah, a wonderful Norwegian painter who lived during the turn of the last century. He died in 1914, so he lived most of his life in the 1800s. And he's called Theodor Severin Kittelsen, most commonly known as just Theodor Kittelsen.
Yeah, he's a very... At least he's famous in Norway. I don't know if he's very well known abroad.
Yeah, he's one of the most famous painters in Norway. Not the most famous painter, but one of the most famous painters.
No, the most famous one is Edvard Munch.
Yeah.
And they lived approximately at the same time, I think.
Yeah, and I think Edvard Munch... Well, I know Edvard Munch was much more popular, but...
Yeah, he painted The Scream.
Yeah.
Which is his most famous painting.
Yeah.
He's also a very good painter, but...
Yeah, I really enjoy him too, but The Scream is his most out there painting. And he has some more out there paintings, but I think Kittelsen has stranger paintings on the whole.
Yeah, in a way, I'm thinking maybe Munch is more like a commentary on society at the time and stuff like that.
Yeah, while...
While Kittelsen is more... Fantasy,
yeah, more folklore inspired, and he's more inspired by nature, while Munch is more inspired by society.
Yeah,
but Kittelsen also has some societal commentaries in his work. Like we saw one painting where a giant troll or a gnome or something is on top of the mountains, and he's holding his ears while a train is just noisily. It looks like the train is crashing, but I think I think it's just supposed to represent that it's like moving across the mountain very noisily, because Norway has a lot of railway lines across all the mountains and everything, and maybe Kittelsen didn't quite approve of cutting up nature in that way, kind of.
It's kind of like the debate with the windmills we have today, maybe.
Yeah, I thought about that when I was looking at the painting, and I was very seriously considering trying to Photoshop in a windmill in that painting instead of the train.
Yeah, because that's a huge debate going on in Norway now, if we want to, like, we have a lot of virgin nature, if you will.
Yeah.
And some politicians are considering putting up great windmills in our lovely nature, and...
Yeah, and a lot of people don't like that, but I think it would be fine. Like on the coast, if you see a solitary big lighthouse, that's a cool feature of the coast. It doesn't ruin the vista, it just adds something to it.
But it's not just about the vista when it comes to putting it up in nature. It's also, it makes a lot of noise, and maybe it, for instance, disturbs birds that are hatching.
Yeah.
So I think they'd be better off by putting it out in the sea.
Yeah, that's true. Like, there is possibilities to have floating windmills, and I think that would be a possible way to do it. But let's get back to Kittelsen.
Yeah, I was thinking, maybe I'm wrong here, but I was thinking that if Kittelsen and Munch lived today, then maybe Kittelsen would be like the nerd.
Totally.
And Munch, I don't think he would be one of the cool kids. Maybe more like a hipster.
Yeah, he would be like in the artist crowd.
Bohemian and...
Yeah, and Kittelsen would be more like the D&D geek.
Yeah, I was thinking that because you showed me one of his paintings that I hadn't seen before, where it was actually a dragon in the clouds.
Yeah.
I was really surprised by that because dragon isn't very typical for Norwegian folklore.
No, and he also has some, like he has one painting, I don't think I've shown you that, with a dragon sleeping.
No, I can't remember, I've seen that, no.
It's cool, but it's not as cool as his other paintings.
I really like the one you showed me with the dragon in the clouds, but yeah. I guess that's not his most famous work.
No, it doesn't really represent how most of his paintings or his most well-known paintings looks.
So he's been illustrating Norwegian fairy tale books. These are folk tales that have been gathered by, especially by Asbjørnsen and Mo.
Yeah, those are prolific gatherers of Norwegian fairy tales.
Yeah, they're like our brothers Grimm.
Yeah, or what's the Danish one? Is that
Hans Christian Andersen?
Yeah, so Asbjørnsen and Mo.
I guess they traveled around in like villages.
Yeah,
in the 1800s as well.
Yeah, so they traveled from town to town and often on foot just to get around to all the little places around Norway, because especially back then there was a lot of small places around the hills and mountains and in the valleys.
Yeah, people lived very scattered because of nature and mountains and forests and...
Yeah, Norway has a small population, but it's actually a really big country, but a lot of it is mountain, so there's a lot of small communities, and especially back then.
Yeah, so they were gathering these folk tales, and Theodor Kittelsen, he illustrated a lot of the books, and also there was this isn't fairy tale, but there was like a book about the Black Plague that he illustrated.
Yeah.
So, and those drawings are very well known.
Like I mentioned in the video, he represented plague as a decrepit old woman that was walking from village to village and spreading the plague.
Yeah, I remember in school when our books were telling about the Black Plague, they often used his drawings to illustrate the Black Plague.
Yeah.
And I always thought they were creepy as hell. This old woman that was hunching and looking more like a skeleton.
Yeah.
Walking around in, luring in dark corners and...
She's pretty much the Norwegian version of death. Kind of, you know.
Yeah, kind of like the Grim Reaper.
Yeah, she looks kind of like him, but she isn't a skeleton, but she's very...
She's close to a skeleton.
Yeah, she's close to a skeleton, and she's very creepy.
Yeah, she looks like very haunting and yeah. But that's a very good illustration. I was really afraid when I learned about it.
Yeah, and she was he used her a lot of times. There was just a bunch of illustrations with, as I like to call her in English, Lady Plague, or in Norwegian it's Pesta, like the pest, but with an A ending, so it sounds like a female name, so Pesta.
Mm.
But in English it works best as Lady Plague.
Yeah, and you have some examples of that in your Theater Kittelsen video.
Yeah.
And of course also the folklore paintings.
Yeah, some of them, but he has so many fairy tale pictures that I couldn't include. He had a whole series of a war between, I think, frogs and birds. No, wait, frogs and fishes? I can't quite remember. There were at least frogs involved. Involved, and there was a war between them, and they're really like much cuter illustrations than he used to make. Like, picture a cute illustration of a frog with a more like human-like personality, like not a, yeah, you know what I mean, like picture a frog with a top hat or something.
Is this from a fairy tale, maybe?
I'm not sure. There's
frogs are very common in fairy tales, I think.
Don't quote me on this because I'm not sure, but I think maybe that this is just a series of illustrations that he was inspired to make.
Okay. Hmm. But when I hear Kittelsen, I'm thinking of the Lady Plague.
Yeah.
And also these troll paintings. Do you have a favorite? Like, what's your ultimate Kittelsen painting?
Well, there's a few of them, and I included those in the video, along with a lot of paintings. But the first ones that come to mind are the troll who sits and wonders how old he is.
Just by the title, I think I know which picture that is. The really well-known big troll that is... It looks like it's pondering.
He's a giant. I think he's sitting on a mountainous hill or something.
Yeah, and I just have to say that Theodor Kittelsen's paintings are maybe largely the reason why Norwegian pictures trolls in this certain way.
Yeah, he inspired our version of troll.
Yeah, like Coca-Cola with the Santa Claus. Never mind.
No, I get what you're saying.
Okay.
And we use Kittelsen-inspired trolls as
tourist traps.
Yeah, tourist traps and souvenirs. So you can get like...
I was just thinking about the TV show Community. Yeah. There's a whole gag about a Norwegian troll.
Yeah. I was seriously considering putting that scene in the Kittelsen video. But I made the video so serious that would not have fit at all.
Yeah, okay. No, but I think it was a good idea, but I think you made the right decision.
Yeah, I was considering like cutting to that when I was first starting to talk about it. And I was saying Kittelsen inspired what Norwegians picture when we hear the word trolls. Not the internet troll, but more the, and then cut and show. Troy Barnes freaking out about this kitschy souvenir troll.
Steal the territory!
Steal the territory!
Norwegian troll!
One painting I really like is the one of the... You called him the neck. I'm not familiar with the English name.
Yeah, I've seen some videos about Kittelsen, call him the Nix.
Nix?
Okay. Yeah, because that folklore creature has a lot of different translations.
In Norwegian, it's Nøkken.
Yeah.
So that's how I know him.
Yeah, and that's closer to neck. And in the English Wikipedia article about him, neck is the first name that comes up. And then after, like, there's like 5 to 10 different versions of the name.
Mm.
And Nix is one of them that a lot of people use for that painting. But I prefer calling him the neck in English.
Yeah, I really like that painting. I remember the other day there was a small storm brewing.
Yeah.
And you and I went on a stroll with our baby carriage. And we went up to this lake and it was very windy and rainy and the water level was really high.
There was a lot of vegetation in the water because the water level had reached higher than it usually was. So a lot of tall grass and stuff in the water.
Yeah, and kind of foggy. And I commented that it was like taken straight out of a Kittelsen painting.
Yeah, it looked very much like the Nøkken painting, which is of still water in the middle of a forest, with a creature sticking its head just above the water surface.
Yeah, you can see like glowing eyes and...
Yeah.
But you have quite a vivid imagination, wouldn't you say?
And like I mentioned toward the end of the video, I think Kittelsen actually inspired me to grow that imagination. Because a lot of his paintings are of Norwegian nature, which of course I grew up around a lot of Norwegian nature. But there's always something strange hidden in the paintings. Like, it could be a whole landscape portrait, but maybe, like, just in a tiny corner of the fantastic landscape, he has drawn some creature or something.
Mm.
Like, a lot of the time, he doesn't focus on the fantastical element, and it's just hidden somewhere.
Yeah, you see a face in the cloud, or a troll in a mountain, or...
Yeah, a lot of stuff like that, or just... Maybe a mountain in the distance, if you look closely at it, it actually has... hair and eyes, and it's just in the background of a waterfall image. Like, it's just some details that he has hidden in the background there, and it's really cool the way he does that.
Yeah, I was wondering if he may have provoked your fear of the void.
What? How?
No, I just remembered you told me once that you wouldn't go for a swim anywhere where you can't see the bottom. Because you have this fear of something pulling you under?
Yeah, I have a fear of something coming up that is hiding in the water.
Yeah, so that sounds very Kittelsen to me.
Yeah, for a lot of people, that kind of fear comes from Jaws. But I'm not really scared about sharks.
No, we don't have... well, we have some sharks here, but not the big man-eating kind.
Yeah, so I'm actually more afraid of water inland than the coast, probably because of Kittelsen paintings, yeah, because I'm afraid that there's some creature in a lake, so I don't want to swim in a dark lake.
When I was a kid and I went swimming in the sea, at least, there was always all this seaweed and kelp and everything, and I kind of had to focus on, you know, not thinking about it. Like when you're scared of heights and it's like, don't look down, don't look down. And I had the same feeling when I was swimming in the sea. I was thinking kind of, don't think about how deep it is. So everyone, please check out Sindre's YouTube video about Kittelsen. I really enjoyed it, even though I'm a bit biased. I was pleasantly surprised.
Yeah, thank you. It seems other people like it as well.
Yeah, that's always good to have someone from the outside confirming that it's interesting.
This is a fairly new YouTube channel. It's not the same one that I used when I was a teenager because I wanted to start fresh.
Yeah.
But the video has started gaining traction and it's getting likes, and it's not getting dislikes. I have no dislikes on it at the moment, but I have...
No trolls there.
Yeah. So yeah, the video is called The Amazing Fantasy Art of Theodor Kittelsen, but I'm going to have a link in the show notes of the podcast, of course.
And the channel is?
Sindralf, which is the same name that I use for my my blog.
Yeah, that's your alias.
Yeah, that's my internet handle.
That's what it's called.
Yeah, it's basically just Sindre and then my initials LF.
Yeah.
But I make the E in Sindre capitalized, so it's...
It looks a bit elven and...
it's geeky.
Yeah.
It's geeky, but still my name. That wasn't the only thing that I put out on the internet recently.
No, you've also launched a Kickstarter campaign.
Yeah, for my comic book Anubis, Dog of Death, which is about the Egyptian god Anubis. After he has lost most of his followers and believers, and has therefore also lost his power, and has devolved into the form of a cute, tiny purse dog. I'm the writer of the comic, but the artist is John Barry Balaran.
Yeah, and he's from the Philippines. Would you like to talk about how your collaboration started?
Yeah, so 1 year for Christmas, I wanted to give you a special present. I wanted to commission a painting of David Bowie and Peter Capaldi from Doctor Who rocking so hard on L guitar that they are shooting electricity out of their guitars, which they use to destroy a horde of enemy robots.
Once again, we get back to your vivid imagination.
Yeah.
But it was based on a conversation we had once, I think. Where I just thought you were shooting the breeze.
Yeah, we were hiking up a local mountain, and when we were walking, at that point I already had the plan for this painting, and I wanted to check with you if that happened in an episode. Like, if they made an episode of Doctor Who, and it could be from any point in time, like which of the different actors who has played the Doctor would fit best with David Bowie.
Yeah, and I answered Peter Capaldi because I feel they're both like kind of old but cool rockers.
They're like aging rockers, both of them. Yeah.
Of course, one with more success than the other in that arena. But still, they had something in common, and they seemed to have something similar about them that I couldn't quite put my finger on.
Yeah, we did play with the possibility of using the third Doctor, John Pertwee, and a young David Bowie, because that would be if the painting was set in the 70s. But we decided to go with the modern era of Doctor Who and David Bowie from right before he died.
Yeah, and I didn't know at the time that you were planning to make it into a painting. I was just thinking that we had like hypothetical conversations,
yeah.
Like who would win in a fight between that and that.
It was that kind of thing, and I was actually just checking with you who you would prefer for the painting.
Yeah, I had no idea because, you know, my doctor is Matt Smith, I guess. But
yeah.
Maybe he wouldn't quite work with David Bowie.
Yeah, that's what we were thinking.
Yeah. So, yeah, you wanted to give me this painting, but you had no painting skills.
Yeah, and before this happened, I had been trying to make a card game.
Hmm. Called Fireball, Fireball, Fireball. That's maybe a future Kickstarter.
Yeah, we can go into how that card game works in another episode.
Yeah.
For that card game, I needed an artist for the card art. So on the website boardgamegeek.com, I put out a call for artists to submit their art and tell me how much it would cost and everything like that.
Mm-hmm.
And one of the artists that I really like was Jeanette Ramos.
Yeah, you've written a post about her as well, so people can check out her artwork if they would like. She's also available for commissions, probably.
I think so. But yeah, I didn't end up using her for Fireball. I went with another artist, but I did like her art a lot, so I saved it in case I found another project that I thought she would be good for. And when I had that idea for the painting, I thought about her. So I contacted her, but she was not interested because she likes painting fantasy art, and this was more a sci-fi piece. But instead of just saying that and moving on with her day, she actually took the time to find an artist she had worked with who would fit the project more. And that was John Barry Balaran. He fit that project very much because he has painted a lot of film posters.
Mm-hmm. Also on commission.
And like based on famous movies, and like he paints the characters in those movies in a cool pose. So that would fit very much with David Bowie and Peter Capaldi standing in front of this horde of robots.
Did I understand correctly also that when you commissioned it, he said that he had always wanted to paint something with David Bowie without having the opportunity?
Yeah, this is some years ago, but as far as I remember, that's something he said, yeah. But yeah, before he sent me the finished artwork, he sent me a sketch. And this sketch of how the painting was going to look, that reminded me a lot about comic books. So I filed that away for later, that maybe he would be interested in doing something close to that style for a comic book.
Mm.
Because I have had so many ideas for stuff I want to write, but some of them are also very visual. And I'm not a good visual artist. I'm good at describing how it should look. But yeah, then I took his artwork, his digital art, and I sent it to a printer who could, I think they're called Fractured.
Mm.
Or Fracture.
They were sponsoring a lot of podcasts at the time, I guess.
So I had this huge print of the painting, and what Fracture does is they print on glass. Mm. So it's like...
You don't need a frame.
Yeah, and it looks awesome. They actually sent me this huge painting, and the first one they sent was...
Fractured.
funnily enough, Fractured. Yeah, it had broken in the mail somehow, but it was very well wrapped and everything. It's like a huge box. But yeah, I just contacted them and then they sent me another one. So we have two of these, and the one that is cracked still looks kind of good. It actually works with the painting.
Yeah, but I would be a bit afraid to hang it on the wall.
Yeah, especially...
You've seen those internet things with the glass tables that have gotten like a little...
Chip,
and then they have like exploded.
Yeah.
So that's what I'm thinking.
What did you think about the painting when you unwrapped it on Christmas?
Well, it's a few years ago now, but I remember being really surprised, and it looked awesome. I was like, how the heck did you make this? And also I understood that you have been sort of fishing out information from me. And in a way, David Bowie represented me, and Peter Capaldi represented you.
Yeah, so it's...
Since we kind of introduced those to each other.
Yeah, I introduced you to Doctor Who, but with the Matt Smith doctor. That's your doctor.
Yeah, that's my doctor. And of course, you heard about David Bowie, but... At least I took you to the exhibition in London, at least.
Yeah, I got a much higher appreciation for him. I always liked David Bowie, but...
Yeah, who doesn't, but...
Yeah, but you made me see a lot of stuff that I haven't seen about him before, so yeah.
Yeah, so it was kind of like... I think you wrote in your blog that it was like a symbol of our love.
Yeah, that's
sounds a bit... cheesy, but
it's fitting.
Yeah, it's a really cool looking painting. So I'm sad that's never gonna turn into a Doctor Who episode. That would have been awesome.
Yeah, because that was what I was thinking at the time before he died, that it would be awesome if he guest starred at one point.
Did they have any plans for that? Didn't you tell me?
Oh yeah,
back in the days.
Yeah, I think it's in the 80s. I think there was a scheduling reason that he couldn't play a villain in a few.
Oh, would have been so cool.
Yeah. The one they ended up with is awesome too. Like, it's too long since I've seen these episodes. I think it's the last episodes of the fifth Doctor, Peter Davidson.
Okay, I haven't seen that yet. We're watching the...
Tom Baker
season at the moment.
Yeah.
We've been watching since, what's his name?
William Hartnell?
Yeah.
Yeah. That's sure. We're watching all the episodes of Doctor Who. We're on a bit of a break now.
Mm.
I've previously, before we started dating, I watched all of them. So this is my second run through of all the episodes.
Yeah.
And
the quality is kind of varying. But
yeah, of course, with so many episodes, that's a given.
And also many lost episodes where the only existing thing is people's photos of their TV screens and maybe a bad sound file.
Yeah, there's audio of all the episodes, but some of the episodes, like the really old ones from the 60s, there's only a few screen caps of the program.
Yeah.
So people have been like stitching that together, and there's even some episodes that are animated.
Yeah, which of course is a very great service for people who didn't get to watch it the first time around.
Yeah, but it's not as fun as the ones that are actually, the footage still exists.
Yes, of course.
Yeah. Yeah, but I remember when you opened the package that I think it was like an hour when you were just sitting in the sofa and like... taking in all the details of the picture.
Yeah, he's an amazing artist, I have to say that. So I think you struck gold there with the cooperation.
Yeah, I'm so glad that we found each other. I think we make a great team. So
yeah, sure. I think you're good for him too. You know, you have visions and...
I get the impression that he likes to work with me, and I hope he does.
I think so.
But then later, I decided to try to write a Doctor Who comic and try to send it to, I think it was Titan Comics that owned the property.
Mm-hmm.
So I contacted John again and asked if he would be willing to make a few pages of my script so that I could send it along to the publisher to see if they would be interested in producing my comic.
Mm-hmm.
Because I've always have had a lot of ideas about what kind of episodes I would like to write of the show. Mm-hmm. And that's really what I would like to be doing, at least back then.
You know, you should have changed the names and made erotic fan fiction, and you would have become like a billionaire by now.
Yeah, but that's not what I'm interested in. But yeah, that's the way to go. But... So yeah, I decided to use one of the many ideas I had for an episode of Doctor Who and tried to make a comic book out of it.
So John sent you a couple of pages and you sent those to the publisher and then you heard nothing. You didn't even get rejected, so...
Yeah, well, I bet they get so many emails all the time, so a non-reply is a rejection. One of these Doctor Who story ideas, one I didn't send in to the publisher, was one where the villain was the Egyptian god Anubis, but deprived of his powers and living as a small handbag dog.
Was K-9 gonna be in that story?
No, but it probably should have been. I can't quite remember.
Yeah, I have forgotten about it, but I remember it now, that it was originally intended for Doctor Who.
Yeah.
But their loss, because now it's turning into a comic book instead.
Yeah, I actually think that even if I had gotten involvement in Doctor Who, which was really a long shot anyway, that a completely unknown author would be contracted to work on that giant property.
Yeah, but you don't get anything if you don't try. Yeah. I've just recently started understanding that.
Yeah, but yeah, even if I had gotten any involvement with them, I might have done Anubis Dog of Death as a separate thing anyway, because I realized that it was such a good idea that it would be a shame to waste it as a one-off villain against the hero of a different story. It was much more fitting that Anubis would be the main character in his own story.
Yeah.
He's still mostly a villain, but he's the main character.
Yeah, or an anti-hero. Or would you call him an anti-hero?
I'm not sure I would, because that is still a hero. Like, he is a protagonist, but he's not the hero.
Okay.
Yeah.
Maybe we go into spoiler territory there.
Yeah, you can have villain protagonists.
Yeah.
But at the moment, I have a lot of the story figured out for the future, but...
It's all in your head.
It's all in my head, so once I actually put it down on paper, like, things may change, and he might start going more in a anti-hero direction than I am currently envisioning.
Yeah, and as you are gaining fans, aren't they also giving you input sometimes?
Of course.
I remember someone mentioned that they were looking forward to seeing him getting his first bath.
Yeah, yeah, I'm considering putting in a bath scene with Anubis. That is not something I had thought about.
Yeah, but it's kind of cool that nowadays that you can like be a figure online that you can have closer contact with your readers and have input, and also they can get cameos in your comic book. That's one of the perks you can get in your Kickstarter campaign.
Yeah, one of the reward levels is you can get drawn in as one of the background characters. And there's even a higher reward where you can be drawn in as a more important character, some with lines of dialogue.
Yeah, that's a pretty cool opportunity.
Yeah.
So I hope somebody will consider that. I'm considering it myself, even though I know you very well. It's cool to be involved in that way and support the project.
Yeah, I think you said that you were going to let it be open for anyone that doesn't know us first, and then if nobody snatches them up, you will take it?
Yeah, maybe one. I was actually fantasizing about me and a friend buying one each and then get someone cool to join us, like Keanu Reeves, for instance.
That what?
that we would buy, you know, John Wick.
Well,
we would buy one, and we would...
Like, I don't think Keanu Reeves is going to show up for this Kickstarter.
No, we were going to buy one.
You're going to buy one for him?
Yeah, we were
gonna... He's really rich, you know.
But I've heard he's very generous. He's bought, like, motorbikes for his stunt people and stuff like that.
Yeah, so now you're sort of giving back to him by buying this.
Okay, Keanu Reeves, if you're listening, you can get a cameo in this... in this... Okay, whatever.
Well, we do really love the John Wick movies.
Yeah, they're great fun.
Yeah. but yeah, when it comes to audience input on the internet and it shaping the future of the comic, like, it's important to know not to cross the line with that as well. I don't want to be like only writing the ideas of the people that are reading it, because
no, of course not. You have your vision in your head, and also sometimes when somebody thinks they give you an original idea, that maybe you have already thought about it. So
yeah, it's kind of funny when I share the comic new places to try to gain more readers. There's always one person that has to chime in and say, oh, Anubis wasn't a dog. Like, I don't know.
You know, that's the... Well, actually...
Yeah.
Nerd.
Yeah.
Nitpicky and...
Of course, it would be much more funny if Anubis was a full-grown jackal up in a handbag in L.A.
Yeah.
I mean, it would be funny in a way, but in a completely different way to...
It wouldn't be realistic.
Yeah. Uh-huh. Oh, God.
Yeah. Well, anyway, you did have a successful Kickstarter for the first issue of Anubis. So you released one issue, both in a regular edition and one with a limited front page.
Yeah.
And you're doing the same thing now?
Yeah, it's a limited cover that is slightly... That costs a little bit more.
It's a really nice looking... I'm looking at the old one. I have it right here with me because I bought it.
You're looking at issue number one, yeah.
Yeah, but the limited edition cover is really gorgeous.
I agree. John is so talented. And
all those details.
Like always, we're going to have a ton of links in the show notes for everything we talk about. So if anyone wants to see what we're talking about, you can just check in the show notes and there will be links for you.
Yeah, and also if you're thinking of jumping on the Anubis train, you're not too late. You still have a bunch of issue number one lying around here, so you can still get them.
Yeah, specifically I have more of the limited edition.
Yeah, they won't be reprinted.
Yeah, I'm going to reprint the normal cover of issue number one, so that's not going to be a problem in getting prints of that one. But the limited edition cover, we only have so many left.
Mm.
So if anyone wants to read it from the start, you can just join in this new Kickstarter campaign and you can get the first issue as well.
Yeah, whether you would like the limited edition or the regular, they are both good looking and, you know, you get the same comic book.
So. Yeah, and if you're not interested in physical objects, you can just get the PDFs.
I love physical objects, but
I agree. I don't quite understand the people that only wants the digital one, besides that it being a bit cheaper and no shipping costs, of course.
Yeah, but that being said, one advantage of the PDF, which I've also read, is that you can really zoom in and study John's artwork.
Yeah, because it's so many details and there's a lot of stuff that you're going to miss if you don't zoom in. But if you buy the print editions, the PDFs of both issue 1 and issue 2 are included when you buy a print edition, so you can go and zoom in and you can hold it in your hand as well.
Yeah, and then you have a lot of American readers, and I understand that's a lot of postal difficulties there at the time.
Yeah, as I understand it, like, kind of the government is trying to sabotage the US mail system because they don't want people to be able to vote by mail.
Yeah, so I've heard. But you have gotten feedback already from some fans who have received your first comment.
Yeah, most are very happy. I had some tweets with the pictures of people holding them.
I've only seen positive feedback.
Oh, yeah, well, it was one person that was very unlucky in that they got a water-damaged one.
Yeah, but that wasn't, you know, a complaint about the...
No, but it's not fun to get a water-damaged comic book. But I, when they let me know, I immediately sent them a replacement, and I hope that arrives to them as soon as possible, because that sucks to...
Yeah, but now it's in plastic, so it should be okay.
Yeah, it's wrapped even better than it was before, so it should not be an issue this time.
Yeah, even though you bought the expensive envelopes.
Yeah, I bought extra expensive envelopes so that they wouldn't be damaged, but...
Cardboard and stiff, but we didn't think about... water damage.
Yeah, we didn't expect the mail to be just left out in the rain, which is apparently what happened.
Yeah, probably. But we are living in one of the most rainy cities in the world.
I really doubt that that it happened here, because no one else got the water damaged copies.
No, probably.
So
not.
It must have been local for the person who received it. And that makes me think that since this was in America... That's a side effect of all the troubles that the American post system is going through now, that they don't have big enough of a workforce, and they don't have like letter sort machines and everything like that, because stuff has been removed to tamper with the mail system. So that like they are probably so overworked that they like has probably left packages out in the rain.
Yeah, we don't blame the workers, of course.
No, but like
we know what it's like to be burdened with way too much work and.
Yeah. That's not on the worker level.
That's for another podcast. I think you have a lot to say about this as well, but yeah.
Yeah. But should we maybe move on to the next topic? A lot of self-promo here, which is okay because it's our podcast. So.
Well, I think it deserves promotion, this Anubis. I think the streaming services should maybe... I think it could be a good cartoon as well.
So you remember what movie we were going to talk about?
Yeah, barely. It's what's it called? Is it called Never Stop?
Popstar. Don't stop. Wait a minute.
It's a very memorable title, as you. And this is the hardcore fan running around trying to find the cover of the DVD.
Yeah. It's called Popstar. Never Stop. Never Stopping.
Yeah, and usually we would have already watched it and been prepared for this podcast, but I've sort of dodged your every attempt at putting that movie on.
Yeah, but...
Not
but,
deliberately, but it just turned out that way.
Yeah, but we're going to watch it before the end of this episode. We're going to do some editing magic. Like, we're going to talk a little bit about it now, and then we're going to go and watch it. And, like, probably in a week we're going to record our reaction to it.
Yeah.
No, hopefully before that. But, yeah. Like, this is a little bit behind the scenes for this podcast anyway. But because we have a daughter, all of these episodes are, like, 10 different times we are recording. Like, because... We can only record so much, and then she has to have our attention. So then we pause the episode, and then we come back and talk. And I try to edit it together smoothly. So if you ever hear a little bit of crying in the background, know that we don't let her stay there for long, even though it sounds like we're just sitting here for an hour without taking care of her. It's like...
Yeah, she's actually in my lap right now, and she's been surprisingly quiet, but she's like hitting the table, so you might hear her from time to time.
Yeah, like this episode, this is, at the moment, this is the fourth recording session of this podcast, because we have to go back and forth between her. And yeah, it's the second day and the fourth recording session.
Oh well, that's life.
Yeah, I'm not complaining. I'm just explaining to the listeners, because yeah. I have been a little bit worried that people are going to think that, oh, we're not picking her up when she's complaining. Oh. We were actually just pausing and making it sound like we're sitting here in one session.
Yeah.
So yeah, Popstar Never Stop Never Stopping is a 2016 comedy. It's sort of like a pop version of This Is Spinal Tap. It's in a mockumentary style.
Have you seen the whole thing before?
No.
No, okay.
But I am maybe not a fan, but I really like the comedy stylings of the band that stars in this film and has made all the music for the film. The Lonely Island. And I thought that maybe before we watch the movie, we could talk a little bit about The Lonely Island.
Okay. I don't have much to say, but fine by me.
So you haven't seen that many of their music videos or heard much of their music?
You showed me one that I have been referring to later, because it was something about movies and tough guys walking away from explosions, I think.
Yeah.
Because that's kind of funny to notice in action movies. Yeah. Cool guys don't look at explosions. They blow things up and then walk away. Who's got time to watch an explosion? There's cool guy areas that they have to walk to. I thought that was kind of funny because it's such a trope, but I'm so used to it that I never thought about it before when I was watching action movies, that it's very unnatural the way these cool guys are just walking towards the camera and not turning their heads at the explosion and going, oh crap, and running and...
Yeah. That song is actually one they made for the 2009 MTV Movie Awards.
Oh.
And it features Will Ferrell.
Is he in the video?
Yeah, he actually plays Neil Diamond in the video.
Oh. Ladies and gentlemen, please join me in welcoming Mr.
Neil Diamond. Where are we?
Which is very strange. But
I think my mom listens to Neil Diamond, but I can't really remember how he looks. Well...
And then it also features J.J. Abrams as himself on the keyboard.
Okay, you just showed me on your cell phone, and that was weird.
So, let me show you some other ones. We are, of course, going to cut out the part where I show her, and then the listeners are going to hear the reaction only. I figured we're going to mostly focus on their most viewed videos and maybe skipping some of them that I don't think are quite as interesting to talk about.
Mm-hmm.
Most of these songs feature way more famous musicians than The Lonely Island, because it was well known in the music community that it was fun to work with these guys, and you got to show off your comedic talent as well as your song abilities. So they have a lot of really famous people working with them.
Aren't The Lonely Island first and foremost a comedy group rather than a music group?
Well, they're both, because everything they do involves both comedy and music. Like, they don't separate them at any point, really.
Okay, so some people are listening to this, like, in seriousness.
No, people listen to it because they like the music, but I think there's very few that don't get that it's supposed to be funny. We're going to get to that.
Yeah.
But yeah, they started out, they were the digital sketch makers for Saturday Night Live. So they made sketches for Saturday Night Live to put online.
Okay.
Like very early on, when that was not a common thing to do for a television sketch program, to put up exclusive stuff digitally. But yeah, Saturday Night Live has, I think, always had a weekly famous guest host.
Mm-hmm.
So I think that's how they first had the opportunity to work with so many famous people. I think one of the earliest was that they worked with Justin Timberlake for the song Dick in a Box.
Now we watched a few seconds of it, and I got the general idea.
I could see from your facial expression that was not amusing for you.
I don't know. I was thinking it kind of sounded like something that Flight of the Conchords could have made.
Yeah.
Only maybe a bit more vulgar.
Yeah, I see what you're thinking.
I mean, the style and everything, and yeah.
Yeah, I think we're going to talk about Flight of the Conchords in a different episode, because I also like them better. But yeah, I would say there's a lot of similarities between Lonely Island and Flight of the Conchords, but just in different genres, and the Lonely Island is considerably more vulgar. So let's talk about their most viewed videos on YouTube.
Mm.
Let's start with their top viewed video, which has 318 million views.
What?
Yeah. Okay. Yeah. And the title is I Just Had Sex, featuring Akon.
I know that title.
Do you want to tell our listeners about our first date, which somehow involved this song?
Yeah, well, it was a first date, so obviously we didn't know each other very well.
Yeah.
So we were you know, trying to find things in common.
This was back in 2012, right?
Yeah.
Yeah.
So we were talking about music, because I consider myself to be a bit interested in that.
Yeah, and what I've realized later is that I'm actually more of a fan of comedy than music. Like, most of my favorite musicians have at least an element of comedy in their work.
Yeah, but you failed to mention that on our date. So you just mentioned the Lonely Island as one of your favorite groups.
Yeah, at the time I was really into them.
Yeah, and and I said I hadn't heard about them, and you were like, "What? Really? You haven't heard this song?"
Was that when I mentioned I Just Had Sex?
Yes, I think you mentioned that. Like, it was crazy idea that I didn't know that song. And I was thinking that you were like 21 at the time, and I was 27.
Yeah.
So I was kind of expecting you to be a bit immature in a way. I didn't have very high hopes.
And then I come with this song. And
yeah, because I went home after our date, and I was thinking that I should listen to it and give it a shot.
Yeah, and that's when you heard this. And you somehow thought that was serious.
Yeah, I'm a bit embarrassed to say that now, but I was like, you're on a first date and you're kind of looking for flaws.
Yeah, I understand totally. Have you ever had sex? I have. It felt great. It felt so good when I did it with my penis. A girl let me do it. It literally just happened. Having sex can make a nice man out the meanest.
So I remember I actually got angry when I heard it. I was like, I was in this period where I was like, you know, youths and their music. It was much better before. So I actually thought this was a serious, like, song on the hit list.
Yeah.
Or maybe it was on the hit list.
Yeah. Considering the views that it got, yeah, it did chart. But it did so out of comedic reasons, at least as much as musical reasons. But luckily, you gave me another chance, and then we started talking about how we both love Flight of the Conchords.
I can't really remember how we cleared up the Lonely Island.
I think that was much later that I realized that you thought that was not a comedy band.
Yeah, I thought I was gonna, like, hang out with someone who would listen to the radio all the time, and I would hear songs like that playing over and over and probably go a bit crazy.
Luckily, we mostly enjoy each other's taste in music, for the most part.
Yeah.
Here's the second most viewed of their videos with 213 million views. It's Jack Sparrow featuring Michael Bolton. So yeah, I think that song is pretty funny because Michael Bolton is supposed to just sing the chorus of a like hip-hop song that's about going to the club and getting all the ladies and spreading money around. But he gets so distracted by just having seen the Pirates of the Caribbean films for the first time that he gets distracted and just sings about Captain Jack Sparrow.
That's a bit funny, but I would never listen to this, like...
Yeah, I managed to focus more on the comedy than on the music, and I think you are not able to set the genre of music aside, kind of.
No, I don't primarily listen to music in order to have a laugh.
Yeah.
For some strange reason, I prefer, like, more serious music, and if it's funny, it's more, like, subtle funny.
Yeah. I think I am also more okay with hip-hop than you are. Like, I'm fine with listening to hip-hop. I wouldn't put on hip-hop that isn't funny. But if it is funny, then I'm fine with it.
Yeah, I'm not sure what I think about hip-hop anymore. I'm not paying attention to music anymore.
But we could, I think we could call Hamilton hip-hop. Like a lot.
Yeah, that, I like that.
Yeah.
That was really good.
Yeah, I think it depends on the type of hip-hop, really.
Yeah, but I don't know if you can call this hip-hop.
No.
It's like club music.
Yeah.
It's not something I'd listen to voluntarily. So that's going to be interesting when we're watching the movie.
I think actually we have gotten a good view of The Lonely Island as a band from before they made the movie Popstar Never Stop, Never Stopping.
Mm-hmm.
So now we're going to have a break and edit in a little bit of music. And when we get back, we will have seen the film and we're going to talk a little bit about it. We're running this, let's go. I'm on a boat. And we're back. Before we started the movie, I actually showed Renate some more Lonely Island videos.
Yeah, I think I've been overexposed now. No, but some of them were kind of amusing. Maybe I even liked some of them better than the most popular ones. Like, I was just thinking that diaper money was kind of relevant for us now.
Yeah. I got that diaper money. I got that diaper money, dude. I got that diaper money. I'm a grown-ass man. I used to not like that one quite as much as many of their other songs. But lately, with changing the diaper of our baby, I've had it stuck in my brain.
Yeah, I think I've heard you singing it while you are okay. While you are changing diapers.
Any other songs that you liked?
You had already shown me that SNL Shy Ronnie thing with Rihanna. I just had forgotten it. That was kind of funny.
Yeah.
But you know, that's more like a skit.
Yeah, well, that's what I think about all of their music, really, that it's more like a skit.
Yeah, I kind of got that now. It's just that I think it's kind of strange if someone asks you what your favorite band is and then you say something that you just kind of watch music videos for laughs. So you kind of tricked me.
back then, and even now, I'm not as much into music as you are.
But you didn't tell me. You were just mentioning these comic troupes, actually, and I thought they were like obscure bands.
Yeah, I didn't realize that many people cared so much more about music than I did.
Oh well.
I have always cared much more about comedy than I do about music.
Yeah, they may not be like miles away from Flight of the Conchords. I was thinking a little bit about them while we were watching the music videos. When we first met and we compared our likes and dislikes, we were both into Flight of the Conchords, but maybe we had kind of different takes because I was more into the TV show, actually. Like, I had the TV show on DVD and was watching it a lot, but I didn't have the albums. And you immediately went out and bought them for me.
I discovered them through their albums.
My first meeting with the Flight of the Conchords was that I watched that live show they had that was on TV. But, you know, that was more for the comedy too, you know, and I hadn't actually considered buying the soundtrack.
Yeah.
And even though I like some of the songs, but, you know, it's sometimes part of the humor that the song is bad, so you don't want to listen to it to relax. I'm more a fan of them as comedians. And
yeah, that's pretty much how I feel about The Lonely Island too. So let's get into the movie. I've got it all, and I'm getting more, but I never thought I'd be the more, cause you know I'm so humble. I'm so humble, I'm so humble, I'm so humble. It stars The Lonely Island, which consists of Akiva, Jorma, and Andy Samberg.
I only knew Andy Samberg, like, from Brooklyn Nine-Nine. I didn't realize those other guys had names.
So, what did you think about the movie?
Well, it was better than I remembered. We got through it. It's silly and it's not hilarious, but I think it's kind of amusing at times.
Yeah, I heard you chuckling a few times.
Oh, really?
Yeah. Do you have any favorite moments?
Well, there were many, like, cameos in it. I thought the Seal cameo was very funny. To me, when I see Seal, I think Batman, Kiss from a Rose, back in the 90s.
Yeah.
Which you didn't realize was a song from a Batman movie.
No.
So I had to show you the music video.
Yeah, and it's just a bunch of Batman clips.
He's standing by that bat signal, isn't he? On the rooftop.
Yeah.
With his shirt open and blowing in the wind. It's quite cheesy, but I love that song.
Yeah, it's really silly.
Yeah, and in the movie he was singing at a wedding and he was attacked by wolves. And he was like, nah, I'm okay.
Yeah, he said, how do you think I got these scars?
Yeah, and isn't that a Batman reference too? Like the Joker?
Yeah, maybe.
Yeah, that was at least my take on it. So I thought that was pretty funny. Yeah, I was entertained. I got a few laughs and... I mean, I'm not very eager to watch it again, but it was fine.
Yeah, I don't think I need to watch it through completely again either. But maybe watching clips on YouTube is what I'm going to do if I feel like watching some parts of it. And maybe like way in the future I will watch it again. But it's not one of those movies that I feel like, oh, that one, I'm going to watch that again quite soon.
Yeah, the reason why I mentioned that was the movie This is Spinal Tap, which I'm very fond of. And I discovered it while I was a student. So it was kind of comfort food for me. I was watching it all the time.
Yeah.
But I mean, I guess the characters in This is Spinal Tap, I kind of find them more charming. Like the characters in this pop star movie, they were kind of...
jerks. Assholes.
Yeah, you can say that, especially about the main character.
But I feel like that fits the different genres of music that these movies are about. This is Spinal Tap is a mockumentary about a rock band, while this was a mockumentary about a super famous pop star. And the members of a rock band, I feel, fits more like being charming and stupid and over the top. While a super famous pop star, that's more fitting that the character is a jerk and also over the top, but in a different way. But yeah.
Yeah, maybe you're right. Yeah, the Spinal Tap characters, they are, you know, they are a bit douchey sometimes, but they are so naive that it becomes charming in a way. I don't know why. But...
Yeah, yeah, the characters in Spinal Tap, like, do stuff that is terrible for other people, but Connor for real, which is Andy Samberg's character. Connor for real is very, very self-obsessed, like much more than this rock band is in Spinal Tap.
Yeah, so maybe he's not really a person you want to spend a lot of time with. That being said, I believe he's very nice in real life, because I don't think he would have gotten all those celebrities to be cameos in his movie if not.
Yeah.
Because the movie is packed with celebrity cameos, which is also part of the fun. I mean, I probably don't know half of them, but here and there is like, oh, that's that guy.
Yeah, and it was very obvious that in all the interview sections of the mockumentary that they were talking to some famous hip-hopper or something like that. And some of them we knew, and some of, like, actually most of them, I don't know who they were. But it became funny because I realized, oh, this is an actual person and what he's saying is, like, ridiculous.
Yeah, one of the rappers, wasn't he arrested in Sweden, like, a couple of years ago? That's why I knew him. Okay, never mind.
Yeah, yeah, so some of the most fun cameos in the film is Connor Farrell's personal chef.
Yeah, he was played by Justin Timberlake. So that was kind of funny. He was just standing in a corner cutting vegetables. And also he was singing sometimes. And of course he can sing. And everyone was like, dude, shut up.
Yeah, just
give him that look.
Yeah, just chop your vegetables and shut up.
Even though he probably sang better than all of them.
Yeah. I remember you saying that it would have been funnier if they had shown some restraint with his character, because right at the end of the film, like, they put that character on stage with Connor for real. Like,
he was inside a fish, but still it was just intimidating.
Yeah.
But he was very, like, giddy because he got to be on stage with Connor for real.
Yeah.
So that was a bit funny.
Speaking of the end of the film, Connor Farrell starts off as a very self-obsessed pop star that has left a kind of boy band group, or like a hip-hop version of a boy band group, right?
Hmm.
And one of the other members of the boy band group is still his DJ, but the other one has just left music completely and is living on a cannabis farm and is making wood carvings and stuff like that. But yeah, towards the end of the film, Connor Farrell realizes that he has been a douche to his other band members, and he reunites that band and tries to become a better person. So he's not a very nice character to spend so much time with, but he gets better at least.
Yeah, that's like a classical arch of these mockumentary about bands.
Yeah.
That they, at some point, they split up. That happens in Spinal Tap as well.
Yeah, but what was different with this one is kind of the split up occurs before the film starts.
Yeah.
So, like, everything about the band is like, oh, this is where he came from. Like, this is where Connor Farrell started, like, ages ago, and now he's, like, at the height of his career. So, yeah. That was kind of interesting.
Yeah.
So, the film had a lot of music, like, original songs from Connor Farrell and his band before that, and some other musicians. Can you mention some of the... Did you like any of these? Or was none of them any interesting? Or
the only one I can remember now is that Mona Lisa thing, because you showed it to me afterwards on YouTube.
Yeah, like, because they show only, like, a snippet of that song in the film. But I kind of like it. Push my weight in the front of the crowd, and I couldn't believe what I saw. Mona Lisa, you're an overrated piece of shit. With your terrible style and your dead shark eyes, and a smirk like you're hiding a dick. What the fuck is this garbage?
Yeah, I was a bit like, why are they making fun of the Mona Lisa? Like, that was a very random thing to do.
I think it's pretty much that to show that Connor Farrell is entirely missing the point of why the Mona Lisa is so famous. He's just judging her by her looks, like the model in the Mona Lisa. He's judging her as if he was going to date her or something.
Yeah, it was strange that he knew about the painting at all. He is probably in like his 30s, but he seems like a teenager who's just been introduced to the Mona Lisa at school and is like, what is this piece of junk, you know?
Yeah.
Like, but it was a bit weird, and I can't really, I don't think any pop star would like bother making a song about the Mona Lisa, an entire song about how she looked like a garbage pail kid.
Yeah. I think it seemed like the character Connor Farrell really tried to be cultured and with it.
So that was what it was.
Yeah, because at some point he also makes a pro-gay marriage song. But he's so worried that he's going to be perceived as gay himself.
That was in that movie.
Yeah, that every other line is, I'm not gay. So... I'm not gay, but if I was, I would want equal rights. I'm not gay, but if I were, I would marry who I like. It's not fair, I'm not gay, that the government has to say.
And who can love who not gay, or to which god you can pray on a gay. Yeah, that was a bit funny. You know, one thing this movie also reminded me of, other than This is Spinal Tap, is a Norwegian mockumentary that is called Get Ready to Be Boys Voiced from the year 2000. It's a mockumentary about a boy band.
Yeah, I can see that. Get Ready to Be Boys Voiced could probably be seen as a double feature with this movie. You could see Get Ready to Be Boys Voiced first to see like the boy band experience and like the group experience. And then you could pretend that the main character of that just changed looks and became Andy Samberg's character. And that is what happened after he left Boys Voiced.
Yeah. They have also a sponsor deal with some fish fingers, I remember. That's a joke in that movie.
Yeah?
Yeah, I was thinking about it, because in Popstar, he was sponsored by this big company making refrigerators and washing machines and stuff.
Yeah.
And that was also part of the plot, that they had made them, like, whenever you were opening your fridge, it would play a Connor Farrell song.
Yeah, like they updated, because a lot of newer fridges and stuff, they have technology in them, like they have...
Yeah, they're smart.
Yeah, so they have an internet connection. So they had updated a lot of appliances. So that suddenly all fridges of that brand in all of America would play a Connor Farrell song when you open them.
Yeah, which of course is a little poke at Apple, I think, for putting that U2 album on all iTunes devices or something like that a few years ago.
Yeah, people did not like that, of course.
And people got mad about it in the movie as well.
Yeah, like, he might have been, like, the biggest pop star at that moment, but that doesn't mean that everybody likes you.
No, and they at least want to have the option to not listen to you.
Yeah, like, it could be your favorite song, but if it plays the beginning of it every time you open your fridge, you're going to start to hate it.
Yeah, nobody wants to have things forced upon them. So, yeah, that was a little social commentary there, which was probably more relevant at the time.
Yeah, I think there was probably a lot of references to different stuff that has happened to pop stars that we didn't pick up on.
Yeah, we noticed that he was in the Anne Frank's house and went to the toilet.
Yeah, like he took a shit in Anne Frank's toilet.
Yeah, and that was, of course, Justin Bieber and his infamous post in the guest book in the Anne Frank Museum.
Yeah, like he said that Anne Frank seemed like she was a cool girl and that she would probably have been a believer if she had lived today.
Yeah, but to be fair to Justin Bieber, he, you know, he was a young boy and I think he kind of got a bit much press and negativity because of it, but you know, he was just a kid trying to write something clever and then the whole world is like scrutinizing it.
Yeah, I know, but it was self-obsessed and that
I don't mean it was a good thing to write, but I just mean that maybe you should kind of, yeah, I think people have let it go now. But we were reminded of it when we watched this movie and you could see Andy Samberg on the toilet in the Anne Frank Museum. So,
Or at least after he had been on the toilet, like he was waving away stink lines, like, ooh, don't go in there.
Yeah.
So have we covered this movie appropriately, you think?
I think so, but maybe you have something to add, some favorite moments or favorite...
I think we pretty much covered it. Oh, yeah, I did like Connor Farrell's DJ and his giant neon helmet that he had to wear. Like, Connor Farrell made him wear this really heavy helmet that was making a lot of noise and was completely uncomfortable for him.
You liked that he was uncomfortable?
Yeah, it was funny.
Okay.
Let's remember, this is not real people.
Made me think of Daft Punk, but I think they may have mentioned that.
Yeah, like this was a reference to This was a reference to Daft Punk and bands like that. But yeah, that's everything that I can think of at the moment, at least.
Yeah, and we hardly needed to sum up anything of the plot, so that was nice.
Yeah. So it's your turn to choose a movie for us to watch for the next episode.
Yeah, you reminded me just before we started recording this, and you also told me that I should maybe consider that the next episode would probably be released in October.
Yeah.
So I thought I should try to find like a horror movie or something in my collection that I haven't already shown you.
Yeah.
So that wasn't many. So there may be a reason why I haven't shown you this one.
Oh, okay.
Okay, are you ready?
Yeah. Killer Clowns from Outer Space.
Yeah.
In space, no one can eat ice cream.
Yeah, that's...
Oh, God, joke. This doesn't look so good.
Mm. Yeah, I bought it for one Halloween. It was probably very cheap. And, of course, I bought it because of the title. And I don't think I liked it when I watched it. I've only seen it once. I remember it as being very slow and not scary and not funny.
Yeah.
But in those days, I used to have movie marathons with my friends. And this one was probably watched, like, really late on. So I'd probably watched a lot of movies and was getting really tired. So I remember this movie as slow-paced and, yeah, like I said, not very... I'm not afraid of clowns in general, so it wasn't that scary to me. How about you? Are you afraid of clowns?
No, I'm not afraid of clowns in real life, but I do think horror clowns are creepy.
Yeah, like Pennywise and... and also the clowns in that season of American Horror Story.
Yeah, those were really creepy.
That was really scary, actually.
But yeah, that is going to be interesting for the next episode.
I think it's kind of a cult classic, too, so... I hope this one is also better than I remembered. So, that's homework for next time, if anyone would like to watch it before we talk about it.
Yeah, so until next time...
Bye.
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 Bye-bye.
Goodbye.
See you later.
Alligator.